Hey guys, it's Dani. Today I have a bit of a special video for you guys. We're gonna talk about orchids from the point of view of the houseplant enthusiast, which is a very different point of view than that of the orchid grower. The main idea is I'm gonna try to demystify orchid growing for those of you who maybe have been put off by this set of rules that I don't know who invented regarding orchids, which I know for a fact can make some of you just not purchase orchids, just not keep them. Putting myself in your shoes, I can see how orchids can seem to be rather unforgiving, unobtainable, and even boring to some extent. But I'm an orchid lover. I have over 450 orchids at the moment in my grow space, and I dedicated 7 years of my life up until now in building a YouTube channel revolving around orchid care. So I think you can say I'm pretty biased. I do believe orchids are the ultimate houseplants. That's up for debate, of course, but I do believe orchids can bring you something that other houseplants maybe cannot. And if nothing else, they are absolutely wonderful companions to have together with your other decorative houseplants. And I promise you, orchids are not unobtainable. They're not hard to grow. They're not scary. They're not boring. What's scary and boring, honestly, are these rules that we just seem to have around them, which are simply not true. So I'm here to shed some light on orchids, tell you my point of view and why I think they are wonderful and they are absolutely worth your time. And this is the first video in what I hope to be a long series dedicated to orchids as decorative plants, as greenery that will bring you joy and will put you through such a wonderful discovery journey you cannot even believe. So if this sounds fun and intriguing, don't forget to give this video a like if you end up enjoying it and subscribe to my channel. I post 3 times a week. And if you have houseplant lovers in your life, do share this video with them so more people learn about orchids. First of all, let me ask you a question. What image do you have in your mind when you hear the word orchid? Maybe something like this? Or maybe more like this, or like this, or maybe like this. Yep, different colors, different patterns maybe, but pretty much all the same thing. Phalaenopsis orchids. And this is because flower shops and garden centers have put so much emphasis on the Phalaenopsis orchid that in many, many places around the world, that's pretty much the only orchid available in these shops for people to purchase. And while Phalaenopsis orchids do have some amazing qualities, they're also not the best houseplants, to be fully honest. Not in the sense of decorating and instantly greenify a corner of your house. They indeed bring something to the table that many other houseplants don't, and this is the beautiful flower show. But like any plant on earth, Phalaenopsis orchids will eventually drop their flowers. And what do you have left then? Something like this, a plant which is green, has leaves, but doesn't really tell you much, especially if you compare it to something like this. The quality of a Phalaenopsis orchid to instantly uplift a corner of your house, make it green, make it more natural, simply lacks. Phalaenopsis are not the plants to do that. And I am the first to absolutely admit this. As much as I do love Phalaenopsis, and I have about 70 of them in my collection, I admit they're not the most decorative plants, they're kind of confusing, and recently I started to fully understand why the number one comment on my YouTube channel is, "My orchid is dying, the flowers are gone, what do I do now, what did I do wrong?" When in fact, when flowers drop, it's actually the most active time for a Phalaenopsis orchid. It is now when it's growing leaves and roots and pretty much comes back to life. Does it look that way? Absolutely not. And that's just how Phalaenopsis work. So one of the major downfalls of orchids is that when the flowers drop, all of the features and qualities you might have purchased the orchid for are gone together with the flowers. However though, Phalaenopsis are not the only orchids. There is a whole world of orchids out there that you can find in flower shops and garden centers sometimes, but mostly in orchid nurseries, which in my opinion are 1,000 times more interesting and better suited for home growing than Phalaenopsis are. So let's talk a little bit about them, shall we? One of the most suited orchid for home conditions and one of the most decorative at the same time is the so-called slipper orchid, actually the Paphiopedilum. This orchid appears in flower shops and garden centers from time to time as well, so you can actually find it if you know what you're looking for. The most advertised feature of this orchid is of course the bloom, which is fantastic, and it fits the pattern that all orchids are grown for their flowers. But there is much more to this than the really, really interesting flower. This is the foliage. Take a look at this beautiful mottling and the wonderful texture that this orchid has on its foliage. And there are so many patterns and shades out there that not only slipper orchids have really different flowers, but also really different foliage. Some slipper orchids are just so interesting foliage-wise that really, who needs flowers? Yes, the flowers are gorgeous as well, but that's just a little bonus to look forward to. In the meantime, why don't we just enjoy this wonderful foliage? And to top it all off, what if I told you that paphiopedilums stay really tidy, so you'll not actually have issues with overgrown plants anytime soon? And more than that, they are so, so easy to grow under home conditions. They don't need tremendous amounts of light. They don't necessarily need orchid medium either because they're terrestrial or semi-terrestrial. They don't need transparent pots, which we'll get to. So the freedom of the pot you're gonna use and where you're gonna place this orchid in your home is absolutely yours. Then how about those jewel orchids? These are again a type of orchid which you can find in flower shops and garden centers from time to time as well. Not as often as Phalaenopsis, sadly, but if you know what you're looking for, you will see them. Jewel orchids are foliage plants. They are mainly grown for their wonderful foliage, which typically has iridescent veining like nothing you've ever seen before. They are terrestrial orchids, so they don't really need orchid potting mix. You can go ahead and use whatever all-purpose medium you're already using, as long as it's airy. They're easy to grow in normal home conditions, and when they bloom, well, that's a little bit of a bonus. But the main focus is their growth pattern and their wonderful foliage. Still not impressed? Then how about the wonderful snake orchid, the Asiocladus spatulifera, which is known for its out-of-this-world foliage that combines shades of green, gray, and even pink. And take a look at those bulbous formations. What are they? They're quite wild, aren't they? Or the cucumber orchid, the Dendrobium cucumerinum. What are these formations that look identical to cucumbers? And can you use them in salads? No, don't use them in salads. And honestly, I can go on and on about these beautiful orchids that maybe some of you didn't even know they existed. But I don't want to give you too many spoilers. I will be sure to present all of these orchids in separate videos. But there you have it. There's an entire world of beautiful and amazing looking like orchids which are just perfect for home conditions. Trust me, my grow room is designed to actually imitate most home conditions out there. And as a matter of fact, I'm really not into rare plants. I want the plants that I grow and that I show off to be available for people to grow, to experience what I'm experiencing with them. The problem is we don't get to see all of these orchids because we only see the Phalaenopsis. And everybody keeps pushing the Phalaenopsis, which is a beautiful orchid, but when it's out of bloom, what do we do with it exactly? How do we integrate it together with maybe our other really beautiful houseplants, like the prayer plants, maybe the Rex begonias? Somehow the Phalaenopsis doesn't always fit. Sadly, some of these orchids are not widely available in flower shops and garden centers, but they are available in orchid nurseries. Some of you out there will be lucky enough to have on-location nurseries. You can visit them, you can pick and choose your orchid. Some of us can only order online, but trust me, there are orchid nurseries out there which carry a multitude of beautiful orchids that most probably you've never heard of. All you need to do is go on Google and search orchid nursery in insert city or country or region such as the European Union. Most of the beautiful and unique orchids that I have are coming from online nurseries. In my country, there is no on-location nursery, but that's okay because these orchids are not rare. You may not find all of them at the same time all the time, but if you visit an orchid nursery, trust me, you'll have such a wide variety of orchids. All you need to do is just research them a little bit or watch my videos, learn a little bit about them and put them on a wish list. So now that we got that out of the way, let's talk about all of these rules we might face when starting to research orchids. First of all, orchids need special pots. They need special transparent pots, otherwise things will not go so great. And well, that's just not true. See, orchids do have quite special roots. That's not something to be scared of though. Transparent pots simply give you a glimpse at what's happening with the roots. You can watch them grow, see the shapes that they can take, see how healthy they are, until you get used to caring for an orchid and watering an orchid. So they're not a bad thing, but it doesn't mean that orchids should only be grown in these types of pots, which I will agree, they're not the most decorative, and they may not blend all that well together with your other decorative pots. One thing you can definitely do if you want to retain the functionality, let's say, of the transparent pot is to use decorative outer containers, which can be any color and any material pretty much that you like best. As long as it fits but doesn't suffocate the transparent plastic pot, the sky's the limit really. And you will not do anything to harm your orchid by using a decorative pot. Orchids can actually be grown in unglazed terracotta pots, actually for epiphytic orchids such as the Phalaenopsis and the Vanda, which is this beautiful girl that I have here. Unglazed pots are a really good choice because they're very ventilated, and epiphytic orchids love air. So pairing an unglazed pot with orchid potting medium can give you this result. And it doesn't matter if you're growing this orchid outside of your home or in your home, it's still going to work great. You don't need decorative pots or plastic pots if you really don't want to use them. You can use something like this or even a glazed pot like this. Some pots do actually have some ventilation holes. This is a specific orchid pot, even though Vandas in flower shops are typically sold either in those big, kind of ugly vases or bare-rooted. What do we do with the Vanda bare-rooted in a stylish home? Simple, we put it in a beautiful and as much as possible ventilated pot and it will do great. So the versatility when it comes to planters and pots is infinite. No, orchids don't need transparent pots or plastic pots. Yes, they help you, but if you really don't want to use them, you can just not use them. And I do plan on making quite a lot of videos on tackling the different planters, things that will just make your life a little easier and again, demystifying some things or at least put you in the right direction. But yeah, it's absolutely fine to forget about the transparent plastic pot. Another rule which might hold us back a little bit is the medium. Orchids need special orchid medium. And well, first of all, not all orchids need special orchid medium. Some of them are terrestrial and they can be potted and successfully grown in the very same type of potting soil that you use with your other houseplants. Indeed though, some orchids are epiphytic, meaning naturally they don't grow in soils, but rather on trees or even rocks. So yes, they do need a different type of medium, but it's not unobtainable, it's not quote-unquote special. In fact, many flower shops and garden centers do carry special orchid medium, which in many cases can be quite suitable, but in other cases maybe not so much because it will include some sort of soil in it. The two bestest friends you'll have for epiphytic plants are bark chips and New Zealand sphagnum moss. You can do with either one or the other, but for the easiest of care, a mixture of both is ideal. Of course, there are other types of media out there which can be used successfully, but these are the most available. In orchid nurseries, you will find these types of media, and most probably they will have much better media than flower shops and garden centers, depending on your location. So do look out for these things at orchid nurseries when you're ordering orchids. For those of you living in the USA, I will link you down below to my partner, repotme.com. We are partnered up and I do make a lot of sponsored videos for them. This is not a sponsored video, but I only collaborate with them because I truly believe in their products. So you have the option of choosing quality media there as well. Or if you cannot find these media at orchid nurseries or specialized stores, you can actually go to the pet shop and you might be able to find them there. What I'm showing you here is bark intended for reptile use from ZooMed. This is Repti bark. And this is sphagnum moss, which can sometimes be used for reptiles. The best brand that I found out there is Best Grow. And these are the two things that will make sure that all of your epiphytic plants, not only orchids, will do great. Other than this, it's bonus. You don't really actually need anything else. Just bark and sphagnum moss, and that's the whole special medium for orchids. Okay, here's an idea that I want to debunk right now forever. Orchids are not suitable houseplants because they have all of these requirements that simply cannot be met in a home. False. Actually, I can think of quite a few houseplants which are very popular that are a lot more finicky than 99.9% of the orchids I have in this room. They are so versatile and so adaptable that I do believe no matter what type of home environment you have, you'll find an orchid that is suitable for your environment. First of all, there are many, many orchids which are not highlight plants. In fact, they don't actually even need direct sunshine. And guess what? Phalaenopsis is one of them. If you can provide bright shade, that is absolutely ideal for many, many orchids. But let's say you cannot provide bright shade. You can always provide artificial light. I don't think there is another houseplant that is so adaptable to all sorts of artificial light as the orchid. In fact, most of my grow room is pretty shaded. I only have one single tinier wall towards the south side. So I have a multitude of light fixtures, from shop lights to kitchen LED tubes to even grow lights. Orchids will not mind either of them. They can grow beautifully under all sorts of artificial light. So whether it's natural bright shade or artificial light, it's all good for orchids. But hey, you have a lot of light, you have sunshine, you have a sunny porch. We have something for you too. How about some Vanda orchids, which are actually highlight orchids? Or Cattleya orchids, which absolutely shine in very bright natural light, but can do quite well under bright artificial light as well. The beauty of orchids is that they're such a diverse family of plants that there is something for everyone. I'm not even joking. And it's not that there's one thing for someone, there's a million things for someone which will enjoy those types of conditions. Then there's humidity. Let me tell you, that fern over there and also the calatheas, oh boy, they need a lot more humidity again than 99.9% of the orchids that I have in this room. Many orchids I personally focus on are very, very non-demanding plants. And the reason why I focus on these orchids is because I want as many people as possible to enjoy them. And if I have 400 something orchids, which are absolutely okay in normal home conditions, including humidity, then that certainly means that overall, many orchids absolutely don't care about humidity. If you want orchids for high humidity, I got those for you as well. But if you don't, I got a whole lot more that don't care about humidity. So even if you have as low as 20 or 30% humidity in your home, don't worry, I got you covered. I got some orchids which are so adapted to low humidity and so rewarding to grow, you wouldn't believe it. And to finish it off, how about temperature? Well, the vast majority of orchids will be comfortable in whatever temperature we're comfortable too, because most of them are tropical. They're coming from pretty warm places. Furthermore, I even got some hot growing orchids. So again, if you have a porch in the summertime, you can put your Vandas and your Cattleyas and your Dendrobiums outside and they will absolutely love it there. Many orchids can actually tolerate pretty cool conditions as well. Don't imagine they can tolerate freezing conditions, but then again, what houseplant likes freezing conditions? But do your houseplants survive at 10 degrees Celsius? Maybe not so much. Most of these orchids will be absolutely fine at 10 degrees Celsius. How about versatility, huh? Next up, orchids don't like overwatering. It's so easy to kill an orchid with overwatering. What the heck is this overwatering that everybody keeps talking about? That's just the most ambiguous thing ever out there. And I'm sorry this rule exists, and I'm sorry people keep telling you that because it's ambiguous and false. Orchids don't like to have their roots suffocated, particularly because they're epiphytic, they love air. If you water your orchid but you give it air at the same time, you're not going to kill the roots. They actually love water. Let me show you something. So this is an epiphytic orchid that I have here. Doesn't she look like a little palm tree? I know, really cute. Well, if you take a look at the surface, you can see this root is growing quite nicely, but it's pretty thin, right? Look what happens when it reaches humidity inside the pot. It immediately expands and grows even greener and nicer. And that's because orchids love water. Any plant loves water. But if it's too much water, to the point of actually eliminating all of the air pockets, if the medium is soil-like and very compacted and very degraded, yes, the roots will be suffocated. Water will help them get suffocated through the elimination of the air pockets. But orchids don't hate water. They don't even hate wet feet. You might have heard this. Well, my whole setup revolves around wet feet. What they love is moisture and air at the same time. That's the only rule you need to know. Other than that, you can water this orchid every single day. If you make sure that the medium is airy, and here's where that bark chips comes in, and if you make sure that the medium is not degraded, it's not soil, and you're not keeping the orchid fully in water like this, then everything is okay. This is not overwatering. In fact, depending on how you keep your orchid, you could actually have to water your orchid every single day, and it would be absolutely fine and actually required. Do we want to water orchids every day? No. That's why we use pots and media. But there you go. Next, orchids need rainwater or soft water, otherwise they're simply going to die. Well, let me tell you, prayer plants are far more susceptible to problems due to hard water than orchids. Most orchids, particularly Phalaenopsis, are pretty unbothered by a bit of salt in the water. Yes, in places where the water can be extra hard, orchids will suffer just like any other houseplant. Also, if you have unsuitable additives in your water that affect most houseplants, yes, orchids will be affected as well, but they don't have a special sensitivity necessarily. What you can do if you have very, very hard water is you can mix it with distilled water or you can collect rainwater, but many orchids out there are pretty tough when it comes to the quantity of salts in water. Vandas, Cattleyas, Phalaenopsis, they're typically pretty robust orchids. I can name a few other houseplants which are much more sensitive than orchids. Here's another misconception, orchids are not fragrant. Well, most Phalaenopsis are not, but most other orchids are. Even Phalaenopsis. This is a different type of Phalaenopsis, closer to an actual species than what you see in flower shops. In flower shops and garden centers, we mostly have hybrids. They're very complex hybrids. They have been obtained through a lot of years to look the way they look, but some traits have been lost. Scent is one of them. But the closer you go to the species, the more prone you are to finding scented orchids. And this, apart from being beautiful, it's also very scented. Species Phalaenopsis might not have as many flowers and as showy flower spikes, but they have other things. They actually look just a little bit better, a little bit glossier. The flowers have these wild colors, generally, and they can have beautiful scents. But these are not the most fragrant orchids out there. Cattleyas are queens. In my opinion, they have the showiest flowers and the best fragrances. Some Cattleyas can smell like roses or remind you a little bit of lilies or things that you've never even sensed before. It's just a whole new world when it comes to Cattleyas and scent. But also orchids can smell like many different things that are not flower related. For example, I have an orchid that smells like chocolate. It's a very famous orchid. And yes, it does smell like milk chocolate, no joke. But then I have orchids which smell like fruit, such as this guy. He smells like raspberry. And there are so many orchids which look so good and have these wonderful unique fragrances that no, it's totally false to say orchids don't smell. Phalaenopsis complex hybrid orchids don't really have fragrances. Most other orchids, they kinda do. Oh, P.S. We also have nighttime fragrant orchids. They can smell a little bit like jasmine or other scents. It really is a big world out there when it comes to orchids. And a last idea that I will mention, I wish I could debunk this, but some stuff are true. Orchids cannot really be propagated through seeds. And that is true. They can be propagated through seeds, but not in home conditions. They do have unique type of seeds which need special conditions, special germination media, which is kind of hard to obtain in a home, and most of us don't propagate our orchids through seeds. There are, however, other ways of propagating orchids, which you will find on my channel, so it's not like we cannot play at all with the propagation aspect of houseplants, but indeed, when it comes to orchids, that's one of the things that is not so easily achievable. Even if orchids might not all be fragrant, or might not all be very decorative, or they might not be very easily propagatable, but they have a thing that, in my opinion, very, very, very few other houseplants have. The feeling that you're actually achieving something. Orchids are just so rewarding to grow because of the way they grow and because of the way they behave. For how many houseplants can you say that you are overjoyed for a brand new root growing? Or a brand new bud or a brand new flower spike that you know will be so incredibly beautiful and scented that it was just worth the wait and the journey and the care that you invested in your orchid. That is, in my opinion, the best thing that orchids, all of them, bring to the table. Whether it's a phalaenopsis or a jewel orchid or one of those weird cucumber orchids, they all put you through this journey of seeing an orchid develop from a tiny little plant into this beautiful, mature specimen that not only teaches you patience, but also gives you something to look forward to every single day. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video and you enjoyed this idea that I have. I promise I have so many interesting videos with orchids that probably you've never seen before. Not even as an orchid grower. I'm here to try out setups and different ways of displaying orchids in a home. As I was saying, I prefer to collect orchids which are easily available, not necessarily rare. Rare stuff, you know, that's a personal joy, and it's okay to have one or two, but I don't like to focus on them too much. So if you feel like you can learn something, do subscribe to my channel, look through my archive, I already have about 2,000 videos on orchids, and stay tuned for more houseplant-oriented videos, including orchids. So with that said, thank you guys so much for watching. Hope you've enjoyed this. Subscribe to my channel for more orchid videos, tutorials, experiments, updates, and other fun orchid subjects. If you wish to support the channel, do consider becoming a member or visit the merch store linked down below in the description. You can also follow me on Instagram and Facebook. It's always nice to stay in touch there as well. And with that said, I'll see you guys next time. Bye!